Hello, fellow mapmakers. Hope you're hearing me well. Everything's fine, and welcome to tonight's live mapping session. Sound looks good. Screen looks fine. Let me know if anything is amiss in the video stream. I hope you're all doing good and ready to do a little bit of mapping tonight again. I'm Ralf Schermann of Pro Fantasy Software, and tonight I want to delve into dungeons a little bit, and specifically how to create some more complex room layouts than your usual rectangular or slightly off dungeon room, and gonna utilize some of Campaign Cartographer's CAD functions to do that, and also mess around a little bit with drawing tools and other commands. If you have any questions during the video, please post them in the comments of the at YouTube. Sue will collect them and forward them to me so I can see what I can answer during the session. I'll do occasional breaks to do that, and that way I can show you anything specific you want to know. Good, so let's get started, shall we? I've got a dungeon, the dungeon layout up on screen here, but I want to start fresh and create a completely new one. And for that, I'm going up to our file toolbar, the one here at the top with all the shortcuts for the different add-ons and the file operations, and I'm going to click the new button. And here I'm gonna stick with dungeons map type, click next, and I'm gonna go with the John Roberts style for the dungeon, which is available for anyone, even those who don't have Dungeon Designer. So, and if everybody can follow this. So I'm gonna click next, and I'm gonna set the size of my dungeon here. I'm gonna keep it small, so we can actually see what's going on, even if I'm zoomed out to show the whole map. So 120 by 90 feet is always something I like to work with for demo maps. And I could finish here and save the map, but I do want to change the background a bit so stuff is a little more visible, because a gray background always tends to obscure mouse pointers and control lines and stuff, so it's better to have a either very bright or very dark background. So I'm going to click next, and for our fill style I'm going to go for a solid fill, and the color black is fine. I'll just keep that, so it's got a straight black background. We should be able to see stuff quite well on this. And everything else, I don't need a grid at this point or anything else, so I'm just gonna click on finish. And I'm gonna save my map. If I can type straight, that is. And here's our blank map. So what do I want to do? I want to start out with a couple, one or two simple rooms, and then create a fairly complex room layout and show you how to do that. So let's start out with our basic room. Okay, Sue tells me my sound is a bit croaky. Might just be my voice though, not the microphone. I don't know. Can't see anything wrong with the with the sound, but perhaps I'm a bit on the top end of the volume. Well, I think it's a bit too late to change that now. I think we'll have to live with my a little bit croaky voice. Let me know if it becomes too hard to hear. Okay, I see the first question in the chat already. Remy wants to do me to do a cat-shaped room. See whether I can get my cat Aza around to serve as a template for that. Okay, so let's see. I wanted to draw a room. All right, so I'm clicking the add room button on the left toolbar up here on the left, and that brings up my room setup where I can set the shape I want to draw. I want to just do a standard rectangular room for now, and importantly, I want to set up my background fills and the wall fills. I'm gonna keep with the gray flagstones, or actually, I could perhaps go for brown ones, so dirt brown, cobbled brown. No, that's not so good for the rooms. I think I'll just stick with the flagstones gray, and the wall stone gray is just fine as well. That's a great. Or perhaps set it off a little bit more. We'll actually go with the brown style here. This is fairly important to note the fill styles I'm using for something I'm going to do later. So I'm going to take note of this. Flagstone's gray for the floors, background, and brown stone walls for the walls. Just I'm going to click OK. And I'm going to clear my throat here for a second. I'm sorry, let's turn off the microphone for a moment. All right, this should be better now. Good, so I'm gonna click the room, and then I'm gonna draw my entrance room here from the left, and I'm just gonna put down a nice little rectangular room to start with. I can also turn on my sheet effects at this point. And there's my little entrance. Now I'm thinking of some kind of important temple or summoning room or something. So it's something that's pretty big and oddly shaped, perhaps a star shape or something else. So I want to draw a big, yes, let's take a star-shaped room here in the center of the map. Be the focal point of my dungeon layout. Okay, we've got the cat coming along, so we might get a cat-shaped room after all. Hi, Asa. And how I'm gonna do that? I can go in and choose the polygonal room and draw like this. And I can do this easily to just draw a very oddly shaped room. So no problem with that. I've got my odd room shape, but that's what I want to do. I want to do something specific, something geometric, something that gives me a nice recognizable shape. And this is fairly hard to do by hand, just by clicking points, if you wanted to make it very regular. So I want to construct my shape first. So I'm gonna undo this and delete the room. And what I do in cases like this, where I want to do some cat designing first, I mean, a cat like with a D at the end and not the cat designing, just to be clear here. I set up my a special sheet and layer to put my design shapes on, so I can easily hide them later but keep them around. And for that, I'm just gonna add a temporary sheet and also same with the layer. And I'm gonna set my fill style to hollow. And my color, I always like to use the bright green. Come, Asa, say hello. Say hello to our viewers tonight. Hi, Asa. Doesn't like to be picked up very much, so we'll leave her alone. And okay, we are setting up our construction sheet, and now I want to design a seven-pointed objects, stars, a staple for magic users, summoners, and so this sounds like a good thing. And we do have some special functions in Campaign Cartographer that allow us to do stuff like that fairly easily. I don't have a function to do a seven-pointed star from the start, but I can do a seven-pointed polygon by doing a regular polygon. And the option regular polygon is on the right click of the polygonal button here. You might not have seen the pop-up menu there because it was outside the video frame. But this is what you get asked. You get asked for the number of points you want to have on your regular polygon. So I want 7, not 6. And then I'm going to choose the center point for our big room. It's going to be here. And then I can set one of the points on our... let's put the flat side of the seven-sided polygon towards our entrance floor. That sounds about good. And there's our regular seven-sided polygon. How do I construct a star from this? This is fairly easy. You just connect points. So choose the path option. Start on one of the corners. I'm using the on modifier with the F5 key to do that. Press F5, get the pick cursor, click on a point of the polygon close to the corner, and then my starting point jumps to the corner. And then we just go to one of the opposite corners. Same again. Same here. Same here. Same here. Here. And here, and there's our seven-sided star, seven-pointed star. Or we could delete stuff here, but this is only helplines anyway. So the other thing I'm going to do, storing a polygon path, I'm going to explode that into individual lines. And perhaps I might do that in a moment. I'll just show you why I want to explode these into individual lines. Now that we've got the constructions, we have different options to create our room from this. And one of the easiest is simply to use the polygonal room tool and use the points of our star to design our room. Start here. Gonna start at this point here, and then next I want to, the next corner of the room is going to be the intersection of these two lines here. How do I get this? I do have a modifier for intersection. Tools, drawing, steps is the intersection of, F6 is the shortcut for that. And that's why I want these to be two individual lines. But at the moment, it's one entity, one path, and the intersection modifier can't get an intersection of an entity with itself. So that's why I can't pick up this intersection here. But if they were two separate lines, then I can say I want the intersection of these two lines. And for that reason, I'm going to cancel drawing the room and just going to explode this and turn it into individual lines. And now I'm going to start over again with my polygonal room endpoint, and now the F6 modifier. You can either select the entities you want the intersection of individually. See, there's my point here. Then I'm going to do the endpoint modifier again up here. But Camel Graph also will, if you hit two lines at once with your F6 pick cursor, it will just with one click grab that intersection. So that's what I'm going to do. And I'm going to alternate between F5 endpoint and F6 intersection to grab my corner points for the room. Oops, that was the wrong one. I can just right click to cancel that and choose a new modifier, 5, F6, F5, F6, and this is going to be my last one, so I'm just going to right-click to finish the room. And there's my nicely regular 7-pointed room. And because we were using our room tool, we didn't need to bother about the currently set sheet and layers, and I can just switch to the wall sheet here, hide my temp layer. And there's my beautiful summoning room. So I could go in and pick up one of the braziers or options or a bloody pool in the middle, put it in there and build my dungeon. But what I want to do, I want to focus a bit more about modifying and adding more to our room layout. See, you can go in now and use the corridor tools to connect to our existing layout here. Say I'm on a 5-foot corridor, no end walls. Don't want to break gaps yet at the moment, or I could break a gap in here. B. And then just connect to an existing wall without the break. And continue working on my layout this way. I could now go in and put a door in here and so on. But what if I wanted to edit this shape a bit? With adding nooks and perhaps moving around certain sections of it, I can of course go in and use the move node modifier to move the corners around, but it makes it a bit harder to do certain shapes. If you're adding nodes, you see I will need in multiple ones for both the floor section and the wall section. Can be much easier if we just could use the edit function of a drawing tool to draw this, to edit the shape, like you could do with a landmass in an overland style. That's one of the room and corridor tools are a little bit older and therefore don't have this direct edit capability. But what we can do, we can set up a drawing tool to modify our existing shape. So as if we had already drawn it with a drawing tool before. So if we go in here, you see the different drawing tool samples. But what we notice, we have either floor shapes or walls, but not a combination of floor and wall as we have here. So we could go in, use our flagstone floor here and use this to edit our existing shape, pressing E for edit, choosing a node, and then do an edit here, do stuff like this. Oh, actually, it does already take the wall. Very good. I didn't think this would be doing that already. So I'm surprising myself here. But that's basically what I wanted to show you, drawing tools. What I also wanted to show you, which I'm still going to do, is how to set up a drawing tool to draw a room like this in one go. Basically combine a floor and wall drawing tool in one go. So I'm going to take the Flexstone Gray tool I was using already. Up, straight, and create a new one. And because I'm not doing only the floor, I'm going to use, I'm going to call it a room drawing tool. Flexstone Gray and brown walls. Okay, and we're gonna add the wall to the tool, we're going to do that by putting it in as an outline. So I'm going to click outline, say it's going to be an extra entity, click the properties. And here it is important that we remember the fill style we used for our walls, and that was the wall stone brown style. Gonna give it a brown color to match that, though this color is not really visible. And it's important it goes on the wall sheet. Also, same with the layer, not on the floor layer, but on the walls layer. And the I could use the current width, but I know my walls are all going to be 1 foot thickness, so I'm going to put this in here. And see the preview here. We now have a drawing tool that can just create rooms like the room command from Dungeon Designer on its own. So let's use this here to add a side room, perhaps with a corner in here. And as you can see, it's exactly the same result as with the room drawing tool. The advantage is, though, that I can now go in, as I did before, and easily just by using the same tool again to use the edit feature to update our shapes. And the other more important thing, because we could do that with one of the existing tools already, I can go in and say I wanted a couple more interesting rooms here on the side. So we've got one seven-pointed star. Say I want some side rooms that have octagonal shape or perhaps pentagonal. Yeah, five-sided is nice. Let's keep it a little bit odd numbers. And I'm going to go back on my temporary sheet here. Use the like modifier to set my settings to the same again. Choose the regular polygon again, and this time I'm going to do 5. And let's add a couple side rooms here. Smaller, this looks fine. And to keep it a little bit regular, I'm just going to do a mirrored copy of this one, do it and choose a middle line through my 7-pointed to make the mirrored copy. But I see I'm going a bit outside of my map border here. That's because my room is not fully centered. So let's just move everything down a bit so I get everything on my map. Here we go. And I could go now go in and use the polygonal room tool again to just turn these into draw rooms along these helplines. But what I can also do is I'm going to use keep on my floor here, and then I'm going to use change like draw tool, one of my favorite commands. So I'm going to say which is the draw tool I want to change my shapes to, and that's the one we've set up before. Our room one. Then we're going to select all the objects we want to change. Press D for do it. And there we go. Both rooms are set up like everything else again. Very quickly and easily. That way you can basically draw or set up your geometrical shapes all in advance just with your temporary helplines with the green stuff I've done here, and then just at the end switch everything into one nice little dungeon layout. And then we can go in and switch back to our corridor tool. And now start connecting what rooms. See, you can connect corridors to other corridors without any problems. You don't need, they don't need to be rooms specifically. Go. Let's put a need to quick click too many in between. Connect this to our polygonal rooms, and again connect it up here. See, not everything needs to be exactly symmetrical. And one more. This time I'm gonna leave a wall in. Connect it here. And even though the shapes are complex and are oddly shaped, they behave just like any other floor layouts. Let's hide the temp sheet again. And there's our nice little dungeon layout. So one thing, if you wanna, you can see that the floors are not all, because they're separate entities, separate polygons, see the floor tiling between the room here and the corridor is not matching correctly. So that's often something you wanna generally adjust at the end of your dungeon layout. We want to do that. I can go in and let's hide the wall sheet for that. And now we set, use the extract properties command to set everything to... Oh, did I miss? To properties of my floor. It was already, but I'm just making sure here. And then I could go in and say I want to multipoly everything. Turn everything into one shape. And you can see now that the patterns all match up correctly, even at the joins between the different rooms and corridors. But after this, because it's now a multipoly, you can't easily edit anymore. So this is, should be always be a last step you do at the end of your maps if you want to bring all the fill styles of the floor into one alignment. Just got a good question from Sue, because that reminds me of something that I wanted to show you too. And that's what else you can do with, if you set up the rooms as a corridor, you can use the trace function to do that. So let's undo here for a moment, turn my floors back into the individual pieces, show the walls again, and the temporary. Say, I've still got a different shape. I can, let's say, what else do we want to draw? So let's go for another geometrical shape first.
Hey.
Say, a nice old hexagon. But perhaps it is not quite regular. Well, we've got something like an extension here. Oops, that was wrong. Like this. And of course, I can, but I've got two shapes now. I could draw along the points, but perhaps might even be more difficult and more points that make it a bit harder. Well, perhaps we could actually, let's say we fractalize both of those, fractalize a little bit this one too. Just the see how hexagon is now fractalized, and I want to turn this into a room. I can now go in and say I want to draw my polygonal room, and I can trace an existing entity. So start off here and say trace, T for trace. Oh, actually, no. My mistake, I can't use the room command for that because the room doesn't have the trace option. What I of course need to use is the room drawing tool I set up. That's what I set it up for. Here we go. Start the tool, and now I can use trace. Trace this object. Start here, follow along to this point. Then trace this object. Go around here to this point, then trace the other again, and there's my traced room. And then again, I can use my corridor to connect this to our entrance area. And it works like any other room I've set up with my room and corridor drawing tools. Okay, I've got another question from Greg. Can the grid be aligned to the tiles? Yes, theoretically it can. It can be a bit difficult to set up the basically, the polygon needs to start at the correct point, the multipoly, if you put them all together. This can be a bit more difficult if you wanted to create a grid aligned to a drawing grid or an overlay grid. I would normally use a flat bitmap as the background and just put the grid over that. That's a bit easier. So let's have a look how to do that. Say, let's go to our floors sheet, hide the walls and hide our temporary. Let's see, change the fill style of all the floors. Let's have a look for flat gray. Solids here, stone gray light. There's our flat gray background. Now I'm going to put a black grid on top of this. Draw hex or square overlay. I want a square grid, 5 foot to the grid. No labels. Apply. There's my black grid. And actually, I want to change this grid here. I don't want the glow effect, just want the transparency. What I'm going to do, I'm going to move this is so this is just above the floors sheet, and then we can show the walls again. And due to our nice black background, the grid is only visible above the floor and not on the background. The walls are above the grid, so the grid doesn't show through those. And there's our nicely aligned floor grid to the walls and the corridors. And that's much easier than trying to actually fiddle around with the bitmap fill and have the grid within the bitmap fill aligned to our grid. Most of the time then the grid, the drawn grid, actually covers up the floor grid in the bitmap fill anyway, and it's much easier to do it this way. if you wanted to do, you could also go in and perhaps play around a little bit with it. Say we wanted to change the properties of the grid. Square grid, we need to thaw that because it's currently frozen. The properties of the grid. The grid is a grouped entity, that's why it's selecting everything at once, even if I just click on one of the lines. And we're gonna make the line width a bit wide and the fill style a solid. So, got already a bit wider line here, which will be more visible in a large scale export or in a print. But we can do even more fancy stuff and work with more sheet effects. Say, no, that's not what I wanted. I want to not do a transparency as such, but do an edge fade inner effect. Very small edge fade. Inner opacity. I often combine transparency and edge fade effects by simply putting the inner opacity of the edge fade at less than 100%. So I had the 50% transparency in a separate effect previously. By now putting it into the edge fade effect, I'm just keeping everything together in one of the effects. Auto opacity 0 is fine. Map units 2. Probably gonna vanish. No, it's not vanishing yet. But you can see we've got a small edge fade effect here. We can still make this a bit wider. Let's double the line width here for 2.1. And then we can even perhaps make the edge fade a little bit wider to, let's make it 3.5. And there we, from this zoom it does look pretty, because the effect is so fine, you don't really see it at this point, so we might still make the edge fade wider. Or what we could do, we could add a blur effect, a small one. No, that's still too large. There we see. That's more what I had in mind, even at this scale. And it looks very much merged into the bitmap already, though we're actually just messing around with the sheet effects on our grid. And from here, you can now go in and fill out your dungeon with effects like doors. See, even breaks proper gaps into the walls. Stone wall here. If you have a little bit ugly overlaps like these ones here in the walls, you can always go in and now let's freeze everything on the wall sheet and freeze everything else for the moment. And I'm going to send these back here. That looks better if these sections are below the ones here. Let's thaw the layers again. So we need a door up here. And we were going to put a pool here, or perhaps an altar might be better. symbols, put a nice altar here into the center of our important room. See, we have the proper shadows, an idol. Which way around is it? It's this way around. Go. Have sarcophagus into the corners. Yeah, ton of snap to place this. And continue working with your dungeon layout at this point. And I think I've covered my topic pretty much here, so perhaps a bit quicker than I originally thought, but it is fairly easy to use the CAD tools. You've seen me doing some design work with different objects, with the regular polygons, and how to turn these into room layouts. How to set up a drawing tool for your rooms. Some of the dungeon styles already have room tools set up that draw floors and walls in one go, but some of the older ones don't, and you can easily set up those. Just combine the use one of the floor drawing tools and add walls as an outline to that. You can use current drawing settings to be able to more easily set these to different fill styles as you go along, or you can set up multiple ones with different wall and floors tools. Okay, we also need a round tool, a round room. Well, yes, we can do this as well. That's perhaps we don't like the one up here at the top. It's too irregular for the rest of our shape. No, not the where are we? Let's hide the grid for the moment. Don't want that to interfere. Erase this. Come on. There we go. And let's create a round room. A circular room is basically very easy. You can just draw a circular room with your basic room tool. But perhaps you want an elliptical room or something that's mostly circular and just has some odd shapes to that. Let's go back to our construction setup. Also gonna erase this, and if you right click the circle tool, you see that we do have an ellipse tool. Turn up snap again. Let's draw an ellipse and perhaps do a combination of a circle and an ellipse. So let's just put the center point of the circle on the ellipse and then draw this here. And now I want to combine these into ones. Again, I can, haven't tried using the trace function on circles and ellipses, but we are just going to try that. For the sake of it, but before we try stuff like that, always good to save our work. Don't always rely on the autosave function. Remember to save your work. That's always worthwhile. Here we go. Say if we had a room here, and we now want to trace the ellipse. It does work just fine. And again, here we can use the intersection modifier to find this point and then trace the circle up to this point. Trace the ellipse again all the way to here. And there's our elliptical and circular room. Very quick and easy. And we didn't put a wall in here, but we can also always go in and use just one of our stone brown 1 foot wide walls. Put this here on top. And then go in and add a door. You can even break elliptical room walls. And there's our door. If I want to hide the temp sheet, I should not let it be the current one. And I'm noticing something that's been bugging me for a while. Sometimes the corridor tools create some strange oddities with edit. It's all on the list of our things to fix, but it's currently still cropping up. See this strange wall? It's half showing, half hidden. That's because there's a point in there that's too much. And let's have a look. If we hide everything but the wall sheets, you can see it even more closely. I just want to show you how to quickly fix this. If I move this around, you can see that I basically have an additional point here, and that shouldn't be there. I can just delete note. There we go. But this is point here is not at the correct location. Let's have a look. Let it undo. Oh, we do need a thing to. That's the wrong one. Let's have a look where we can delete a note and get it correct. This deletes the node at this point. It's not what we want. What we can do is move this, delete this node up here, and then move that to its correct location. There we go. And quick edit there at the point, removing the extra node will take care of that problem. See, the wall is showing correctly again now. So that was a little bonus showing how to fix this problem if it crops up in your corridor tools. You know, always depends a bit on which direction you draw walls in and where you start breaking or connecting to existing walls. Good, any more questions? Happy to still answer some. If not, I'll be happy to call this map finished for now and let you experiment yourself with dungeon layouts. Also, another good tip, perhaps a little extra, if what I tend to do in a drawing style I'm going to use for a while, I'm going to set up a drawing tool for my temporary construction lines. That's very easy. I'm just gonna take one of the current properties tools. We had the wall tool here, or let's just, yeah, there was our wall current properties. So we'll just use any name you want. If you want to show it up on the wall, among the wall tools, we can just call it wall construction. Set our properties to the stuff we want to set, use. So the temp sheet. Not the current properties, the color is color 1, the layer is temporary, fill style, the current width should be 0 for just the line, then the fill style doesn't matter, but just to be sure, we can just set the fill style to hollow. And there's our tool. And even if you're creating a new map that doesn't have the temporary sheet yet, using that tool from the style will just add the sheet to your map automatically. And you can use that to hide and show your construction lines as you need them. Good, and that shall be it for tonight. Thank you for watching. Hope you enjoyed that. I hope you can use it for your own maps in the future. If you want to show off your work and ask questions and just talk about the program, join us on the community forum at profantasy.com or on the CC3+ Facebook group, a very friendly and welcoming community where people show their maps and get help for their problems and looking for suggestions. And we're always happy to see new people join. Thanks again and have a good night. I'm signing off. Bye-bye.